I've said this before and I'll say it again. I love walking through the code from big protocols. Often, reading documentation isn't enough to understand how a protocol works or become competent in how to use it. And reading the Solidity code is really the only way to figure it out. Today, we're covering the position contract in Uniswap V3. Positions are created when you stake tokens in a pool to earn fees and provide liquidity for others to swap. Positions are a huge part of Uniswap and are crucial to understanding pools. Let's walk through the position contract, line by line, and I'll explain everything. Let's go. After declaring our version of Solidity, we import a few libraries to help us with some math. We import full math, which provides functions to multiply and divide with high precision. It's implemented in assembly. We import fixPoint128, and this defines a constant called Q128, a value which in base 2 is a 1 followed by 128 zeros. That's all it does. It defines one value. Then we have liquidity math, and this has a function which takes the current liquidity and adds the change in liquidity to it. And don't worry, I'll point out where we use functions from these libraries as we encounter them in this position contract. Now keep in mind, while I casually refer to Position.sol as a contract, it's not. It's actually a library. That means you can import it into other contracts and call its functions, but on its own, it's not a contract and cannot hold state. And this position.sol is imported exclusively into the Uniswap V3 pool. We can see that here on line 12. And it's heavily used in this contract, though I don't recommend starting here because this is really a beast of a contract at 870 lines. We start by defining a struct called info, which is a template for the information that a position stores. The info struct is referenced in our two below functions, get and update, but it's also referenced in the pool contract. Let's hop back over to that for a second, and if you go down to line 37, you'll see a mapping. And this is a mapping from bytes 32 hashes to these position structs. And this is a mapping that stores all positions. Back to position.sol. What you'll quickly realize is that a lot of Uniswap contracts reference each other, and understanding any contract helps you understand the others. Inside the info struct that represents a liquidity position, we have liquidity, which is the amount of liquidity in the position. Pretty straightforward. We have fee growth inside zero last x128, and this is the fee growth per unit of liquidity for token zero when the position was last updated. And the only reason we track this is to compare it to the current fee growth that gets passed in as an argument to the update function below. The difference between these two fee growths are used to calculate tokens owed to the position owner. We'll come back to this in a moment. Now when you see that, the data type is uint256 and the name of the attribute ends with x128, we can deduce that the value stored here is in the format q128.128, meaning it's a fixed point value with 128 bits on the left and 128 bits on the right side of the decimal place. This again comes into play in our update function below. Now we have fee growth inside one last x128. So the first here pertains to the first token in the swap, and then the one with one pertains to the second token in the swap. And then we have tokens owed, which are fees owed to the position owner pertaining to the first and second token. We only have two functions in this contract, get and update. Let's start with the get function. This is called in several places in the pool contract, and it looks up a position given the owner's address, and the positions tick lower and tick upper. Self here is a mapping from bytes 32 hashes to positions, containing all the positions that exist, and the keys in this mapping are a hash of owner, tick lower, and tick upper. So what we're doing here is we are building that hash of the owner, tick lower, and tick upper, passing that to the mapping of bytes 32 to the info struct, which represents a position, and we're using that to look up the current position. Now the update function. This again is called from the pool contract, and it updates fee growth and fees owed to the current position. The arguments we pass in are the current position, the struct instance for that, liquidity delta, the change in the position's liquidity as a result of the position being updated, and the term delta just means change in something, fee growth inside 0x128 and 1x128. And if you look at the pool contract, you'll see on line 441, big contract here, that this fee growth inside for the first and second token come from a function called get fee growth inside on the ticks contract. And then those are passed directly into update on the position contract. So we're not actually calculating those values inside of position here. They're calculated outside and then passed in. Inside this function, we merely take those passed in arguments and we use them to update the existing fee growth attributes on the position struct instance. Now I'll cover the tick contract in another video very shortly. But let's continue on walking through the code here. We start by copying the current position from contract state to memory. We define a variable called liquidity next, and eventually this overwrites the current liquidity on the position, hence the name liquidity next. And if liquidity delta is zero, meaning the liquidity on the position did not change, we validate that liquidity is greater than zero, otherwise we throw an error. And if that error is not thrown, we take liquidity on the position in memory and we assign that to liquidity next. Otherwise we call liquidity math.add delta, and liquidity math is one of the libraries we imported at the top, and we pass in the liquidity on the position in memory, and we pass in the liquidity delta that was passed into this function, and we use add delta to add them together, and we assign that to liquidity next. Now we do the calculation to update tokens owed on the position, starting with the first token. And we call fullmath.moldiv that we also imported at the top. And this function basically does A times B divide C, where A is fee growth now less fee growth on the position at the last time it was updated. B is liquidity in the position, and we multiply this by the change in fee growth, because if you remember, the fee growth is the fee growth per unit of liquidity. So we multiply these to get the total fee growth. And then C is just the fixed point value that we imported, and we divide by this to shift A times B to the right. The fee growth has x128 in the name, meaning it's in the format Q128, so we divide by this Q128 value to convert it into a human readable number that will be set on tokens owed 0. Uniswap likes to use these Q formats. Let me know if I should cover them in a future video. Then we do the same thing for tokens owed relating to the second token in the swap. Now we finally get to updating values on the position. If the liquidity delta was zero, as in it did not change, skip this line. If liquidity changed, we update the liquidity on the position to the value of liquidity next that we set above. Then we take the passed in fee growth for the first token and the second token, and we update the position's fee growth inside last X128 for the first and second position, so that the next time this update function is called, we can compare the fee growth at that point to the fee growth that we're saving now. And finally, if tokens owed for the first or second token are above zero, we add the amounts we calculated to tokens owed on the struct instance. Now, to give you some high-level intuition, when a swap is made, fee growth is added to the pool. If when that happens, the pool tick is inside the position's tick limits, then fee growth is allocated to the position. And the fee growth and liquidity in the position determines how much tokens owed to the owner of the position are increased by. If you found this helpful, give this video a like and subscribe. If you have questions, leave them in the comments. Otherwise, I'll see you next time.